Hey, race fans, Happy New Year. Robin Miller, continuing our Tough Guy series. Well, today, my favorite tough guy, one of my favorite tough guys of all time, Gary Bettenhausen. And we'll pick up his career in the late 60s, early 70s, when he became a star in USAC in a sprint car. Now, if you saw him drive a stock car in the mid-60s or midget, you're thinking, eh, this guy's not going to make it. He was so determined to follow his father's footsteps and become a good professional race driver, probably the most determined guy ever, and he made himself a good race driver. So by 1970, 71, 72, he is battling this man, Lightning Larry Dixon, for the USAC Sprint Car Championship, the most coveted title you could get back then. And here's him and Lightning Larry at Winchester dueling. Here he is in Willie Davis's sprint car in 1972 at Terre Haute. So, because of his success in a sprint car, Roger Penske snapped him up to drive his Indy car. Amazing. USAC champions got hired to be Indy 500 drivers back then. It was a novel concept that worked. Gary, as we know, 1972, he's long gone. He leads 138 laps in the Indy 500. He's got a big lead. With 18 laps to go, the ignition fails. He doesn't win Indy. He would have been Penske's first Indy winner instead of Mark Donohue, who did win that race. So the Bettenhausen curse continues at Indy. Then, as we know, in 1974, Gary goes to Syracuse, New York. And by that time, you know, Gary's one of those guys who was running balls to the wall. If you had to run up against the fence, wide open against the cushion, that's the way he raced. And he told everybody at Syracuse, I'm going to run this thing. It was a USAC Silver Crown race. I'm going to run this thing wide open around Syracuse. Well, he hooks a rut, goes out of the ballpark, lands on a concession stand, and basically becomes a one-armed race driver. He does all kinds of nerve damage to his left arm. So he's in this hospital. He gets fired by Roger Penske, who kept telling him, quit driving sprint cars and midgets. You're my Indy driver. I got you a Matador ride in NASCAR. You're going to make a lot of money. Just don't be like your dad. Don't be a cement head. Well, he was. And as his best buddy, Bill Vukovich, here's old Vuki right there, as we used to laugh all the time at lunchtime, you know, Schmuck, if you weren't so hard-headed and you weren't so much like your dad, you'd have been the first five-time Indy winner, which he probably would have been. And we'd never heard of Tom Sneven, Rick Mears, and all the guys that followed after Gary lost his ride. Let's fast forward to 1975, indoors at Fort Wayne. Gary's comeback. His left arm's useless, so they Velcro it to the steering wheel. He wins the 100-lap race indoors. So we're ecstatic. The Schmuck is back. It's great. But then we keep thinking, okay, that was an indoor midget race. How's he going to be at Eldora at Terre Haute in a sprint car with one arm? Or what about the Indianapolis 500? How's he going to drive that with one arm? Well, as Gary showed us, damn well for the next 20 years. He had to change his driving style. No more wrestling cars around and manhandling cars. He had to become smooth and smart and straight sometimes to win races. But he outthought guys, and he changed his driving style. And that's exactly why he won two USAC Silver Crown championships, because he outsmarted a lot of guys, and he got that car to work on the bottom, and that was the magic of Gary Bettenhausen. But his finest moment ever was 1980. Sherman Armstrong gives him an old Indy car. Him and Willie Davis are reunited. They throw this thing together. Gary's on the bubble for 2 hours, but he makes the race. He starts 32nd, Indy 500, charges to third, passes Gordon Johncock with a couple laps to go. He finishes third in the Indy 500 just at the beginning of the Grand Effects age, and he's got this old car. When he pulls into the pits after the race, he gets as big an ovation as the winner Johnny Rutherford did, because so many people knew Gary and what he'd been through and what determination and fighting spirit he had. And I was a little bit different, because I bought Gary and Merle's old midget, so I kind of became part of the family for a few years in the 70s, and I'd go to lunch with him and hang out at the shop. And we nicknamed him the Fuhrer, because it was Gary's way or the highway. This is a classic picture of him smoking a cigarette with his good arm tucked in and his armadillo hands, as Vuki nicknamed him. You're an idiot. You don't know what you're doing. We loved it when Gary yelled at us and dictated policy to us, because that's the way he operated. And it was just, he was so inspiring. And if you weren't inspired by Gary Bettenhausen, I mean, he was like the Pied Piper. We'd do anything he told us, because we saw, you know, it worked and how his determination overcame things. And I think he was very inspirational to a lot of people, myself included. So what happens is, he sets quick time in the 1991 Indy 500. Unfortunately, it's on day two, so he doesn't win the pole. And his career really peaked probably in the early 80s after Indy finished in third and winning the Silver Crown Championships. And his last race was in the mid-90s. But we still get him to come out to lunch every now and then. And some of my favorite stories and memories are Gary sitting at lunch and arguing with Koonsman and Bubby and Vuki and everybody about the good old days. But my favorite picture is him and Merle. Now, Merle's got a hook because he lost his right arm in his only IndyCar start at Michigan in 1972, made a hell of a comeback in that Bettenhausen spirit, won a couple midget races, and then Gary got hurt in his bad left arm, so they're beholden to beer with their two bad arms. Well, we have a AAA baseball team here in Indianapolis, and one year they said, why don't you get the race drivers together, we'll play a game, a softball game before the Indians game. So we silver taped the Bettenhausens together so we'd have two good arms. During the seventh inning stretch, I got up in the PA system and said, hey, by the way, at the end of the game, the Bettenhausen brothers are going to be signing their book, Farewell to Arms. Well, the Indians players were appalled. They could not believe, you guys are sick, what's wrong? No, that was the Bettenhausen way. That was their sense of humor. They laughed at adversity and they kicked it in the butt because that was Gary's middle name, man. I mean, he was so inspirational, and just watching what he was able to accomplish in his career was amazing. We lost him last March. He died at the age of 72, but my God, he lived a lot in those 72 years. And we still talk about him every Friday at lunch. There's always a Bettenhausen story. And I can tell you this, from a guy that got to cover him and got to be around him and own one of his race cars and just be in the Bettenhausen family for a while, it was an honor and a privilege. And we salute the Schmuck, Gary Bettenhausen. Thanks for watching. This is Robin Miller for Racer.com.